Assalamu alaikum everybody. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. Praise be to Allah, peace and blessing be upon his messenger, Prophet Muhammad, his family, and his companion. Today we are going to talk about the prophetic family. We are going to talk about the noble family of the Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him. First of all, we have to say that all pictures of the Prophet's family, peace and blessing be upon him, are not real photos. Abdullah ibn Abdul-Muttalib, the father of the Messenger of Allah, the father of our Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him. Today we are going to talk about Abdullah ibn Abdul-Muttalib, the father of the Messenger of Allah, the father of our Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him. Here is Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him. His father is Abdullah. His grandfather is Abdul Muttalib, his second grandfather is Hashim, his third grandfather is Abd Manaf, and his fourth grandfather is Qusay ibn Kilab ibn Murra, and Kilab ibn Murra is one of the Ishmael descendants of Prophet Abraham, peace and blessing be upon him. Now, we have to know everything about Abdullah, the father of our Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him. Abdullah means, what is the meaning of the word? It means, Abdullah means the servant or the slave of Allah, the servant or the slave of God. This is the meaning of the word, servant of God or slave of God. So, his father was Abdul Muttalib. Abdul-Muttalib, Ibn Hashim, Ibn Abd Manaf, and you know Abd Manaf was well known as Al-Mughira. I talked about this. And Abd Manaf is the son of Qusay, and Qusay's name was Zaid. Qusay ibn Kilab, ibn Murra, ibn Ka'b, ibn Lu'ay, ibn Ghalib. Ibn means the son of Ibn Fahr, and Fahr name was Quraish, whose tribe was named Quraish after him. Quraish ibn Malik ibn al-Nadr, al-Nadr name was Qais, ibn Kinana, ibn Khuzaima, ibn Mudrika, and Mudrika was Amir, ibn Ilyas, ibn Mudar, ibn Nizar, ibn Ma'd, ibn Adnan. Abdullah's mother was Abdullah's mother was Fatimah, the daughter of Amr ibn Aiz ibn Imran ibn Makhzum ibn Yaqdha ibn Murra. So they all unite at Murra. Abdul-Muttalib had 10 sons. Abdul-Muttalib had 10 sons, Al-Harith, Al-Zubayr, Abu Talib, Abdullah, Hamza, Abu Lahab, Al-Ghidaq, Muqawwam, Safar, and Al-Abbas. And some historians reported that they were 11 sons, and the 11th one was called Qasm. And other historians reported that they were 13 sons for Abdul-Muttalib, and the other two were Abd al-Ka'ba, means the slave of al-Ka'ba, and Hagla. Most of researchers said that they were only 10 sons, and that Abd al-Ka'ba, he is al-Muqawwam. And this is his nickname. And Hagla was Al-Ghidaq. And this is only his nickname. And there were no one called Qasm. So most of the historians agree that they were only 10 sons for Abdul-Muttalib. And Abdul-Muttalib had 6 daughters. Al-Hakim was called Al-Bayda, Barra, Atika, Safiya, Arwa, and Umayma. Al-Hakim was the only white one. That is why they called her Al-Bayda. Al-Bayda means the white. So they called her the white, because she was the only white one. And she was the twin of Abdullah, the father of Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him. So Al-Bayda was the twin of Abdullah, who is the father of our Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him. Abdullah was the smartest of Abdul-Muttalib's son. He was very, very smart and the chastest and the most loved. And he was also the son whom the divination arrows pointed at to be slaughtered as a sacrifice to the Al-Kaaba. When Abdul-Muttalib had 10 sons and they reached maturity, he divulged to them his secret vow. You know the secret vow of Abdul-Muttalib? I talked about this. Remember when Abdul-Muttalib was digging the Zamzam well? At that time, Quraish refused and protested to let him dig near the Kaaba. And they said to him, "We are not going to let you dig in the Kaaba, and you are not going to let you dig near our idol Isaf." At that time, Abdul-Muttalib had only one son, Al-Harith, and he asked him to help him in digging until those people stop protest and to help him with those people. And when Abdul-Muttalib did the job alone with his son, and when he felt it was hard to dig, he went to Al-Kaaba and held its door and prayed to Allah to grant him 10 sons to help him. And he vowed that he would sacrifice one of them for him. He asked Allah to give him 10 sons. And he said, "Allah, if you give me 10 sons and to help me in serving the house and in doing all what you want, I would sacrifice one of them for you." He told his sons about this secret vow, and they acquiesced silently and obediently. Their names were written on divination arrows. So all of his sons accepted and to let their father fulfill his promise with Allah. Their names were written on divination arrows and given to the guardian of their most beloved goddess, Hubal. The arrows were shuffled and drawn. An arrow showed that it was Abdullah to be sacrificed. So Abdul-Muttalib then took the boy to the Kaaba with razor, and his heart was bleeding, but he had to fulfill his promise with Allah. He had to fulfill his promise. He took the boy and went to the Kaaba and wanted to slaughter his son at Isaf and Na'ila idols. Quraish refused to let him do it. And they said to him, "If you do this and you are the master of your people, then everyone may follow you." Quraish and also the uncles of Abdullah from Makhzum tribe and his brother Abu Talib, the brother of Abdullah, tried to prevent Abdul-Muttalib from doing this purpose. He then sought their advice as regard his vow. He said to them, "What can I do? What can I do with my vow? I promised Allah to do this, and he gave me 10 sons, and I have to fulfill my promise." They suggested that. They said to him, "We are not going to let you do this, but we suggest that you summoned a she diviner in Al-Madinah to judge. Maybe she may find a solution. Maybe she may find answer for you." So they went to see her in Al-Madinah. So they traveled to Al-Madinah to see her. When they reached Al-Madinah, people told them that she is in Khaybar. They went to her and they told her about everything. She asked them, "How much do you take for a blood money?" So she asked them, "How much do you take for a blood money?" Blood money is that if someone is killed, the Arabs used to take something instead of this killing as a compensation for this killing. and this what they call blood money. They replied 10 camels. So she ordered that the divination arrows should be drawn with respect to Abdullah as well as 10 camels. So she said, now make the divination arrows between Abdullah and 10 camels. And she added that drawing the lots should be repeated with 10 more camels every time the arrow showed Abdullah. So every time if the arrow showed Abdullah, you have to increase 10 more camels and make it again, repeat the process again. So they returned back to Mecca, very happy that they find a solution. It may work. Abdul-Muttalib went to Al-Kaaba and prayed to Allah, and he gave the arrow of Abdullah and the arrow of the camels to the guardian of the idol Hubal, but the arrow pointed to Abdullah. Abdul-Muttalib added 10 more camels, and he stood near the idol Hubal, praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abdullah was looking at Al-Kaaba and praying to the Rabb Al-Kaaba. He said, praying to Allah, who is the God of the Kaaba. But the Arabs at this time associate hovels and associate idols with Allah. But the arrow pointed to Abdullah. Abdul-Muttalib added 10 more camels, and he stood near the idol Hubal, praying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the arrow pointed to Abdullah again. Abdul-Muttalib added 10 more camels, and he stood near the idol Hubal, praying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the arrow pointed to Abdullah again. Then Abdul-Muttalib added 10 more camels, and he stood near Hubal, praying to Allah. And the operation was thus repeated until the number of camels amounted to 100 camel. And Abdul-Muttalib stood near Hubal, praying to Allah. At this point, the arrows showed the camels. So when the camels reached 100, the arrows showed the camels. Abdul-Muttalib was so happy to save his son, and all the people were so happy because Abdullah was saved. All the people love Abdullah because he was very nice to all of them. Abdul-Muttalib said, I will repeat 3 more times to be sure that I fulfilled my promise with Allah. So the people said to him, no, this is enough. Your God is happy with you now. You are going to sacrifice 100 camel. But he said, no, I have to be sure that I fulfilled my promise with Allah. I repeat 3 more times. And he insisted to repeat the process 3 more times. And to be sure that he fulfilled his promise with Allah. And every time the arrow showed the camels. Consequently, they were all slaughtered. The slaughtered camel were left for anyone to eat from human or animal. And at that time, the Arabs, when they slaughter something, they leave it for all people to eat, and they don't eat from it. They said, no, not for Bani Hashim. Not Bani Hashim never eat this. So he gave it all to people. He left it for all people, even for animal. But they don't touch it because they say, we already gave it. We already sacrificed this. This incident resulted in a change in the amount of blood money usually accepted in the Arabian Peninsula. It had been 10 camels, but after this event, it has been increased to 100 camel. And Islam later on approved this 100 camels. They approved 100 camel as a blood money, as blood money. If someone was killed, Islam approved 100 camel. Another thing closely relevant to the above issue is that the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, once said, I am the offspring of the slaughter too, meaning Ishmael and Abdullah. This hadith is written in Al-Bukhari, and in it is in Ibn Hisham for Sira, for biography of Prophet, and Rahmatan lil Alameen. Abdullah was the nearest one to Abdul-Muttalib hearts. You know, this hadith means, I am the offspring of the slaughter to, means Ishmael and Abdullah, because Prophet Abraham was going to slaughter Ishmael also, and Abdul-Muttalib was going to slaughter Abdullah, the father of the Prophet. But they both of them were saved from slaughtering. So that's why Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, said that I am the offspring of the slaughter too, means Ishmael and Abdullah. Abdullah was the nearest one to Abdul-Muttalib heart. And when he survived the slaughtering, and his father slaughtered 100 camel to save his life, Abdul-Muttalib then wanted to see his son Abdullah married. Historians have agreed that Abdullah was a very handsome man, and he enjoyed a fine character and elegant manners. The Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, was a light in the face of his father, Abdullah. Many historians mentioned that a woman saw this light in the face of Abdullah between his eyes, and that she offered herself to him, but he refused and married Amina. After he married Amina, and Amina become pregnant in our messenger and our Prophet, peace and blessing be upon him, this woman saw Abdullah again passing by her, but she didn't talk to him. And when he asked her, why do you not offer me what you did yesterday, she answered, the light that I saw in your face has gone. And historians said that after he married Amina, the light in his face has gone. Abdul-Muttalib chose Amina, daughter of Wahb ibn Abd Manaf ibn Zahra ibn Kilab, as a wife for his son Abdullah. She thus, in the light of this ancestral lineage, stood eminent in respect of nobility, of possession and descent. Her father was the chief of Bani Zahra and the highest in lineage and honor. And she was their only child. She has no sisters. She had no brothers. That is why our Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him, has no aunts from his related to his mother, the mother of Abdullah, the mother of Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him, was called Amina, and she was the only child of her parents. So, and her father was the chief of Bani Zahra and the highest in lineage and honor. Banu Zahra is a clan of Quraish tribe. Zahra was the elder brother of Qusay ibn Kilab. We talked about him in Qusay ibn Kilab video. You know, Zahra was the elder brother of Qusay ibn Kilab. Qusay ibn Kilab, you know Qusay ibn Kilab, the fourth grandfather of Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him. And he was also an ancestor of Abdullah ibn Abdul-Muttalib. And Qusay ibn Kilab was the chief of Mecca, or the king at that time of Mecca, and the leader of Quraysh tribe. And you know, Kilab ibn Murra was an Ishmaelite descendant of Prophet Abraham, peace and blessing be upon him. Qusay ibn Kilab was the first Quraysh custodian of the Kaaba. Okay, now, mother of Amina. Mother of Amina was Barra. Barra bint Abd al-Uzza ibn Uthman ibn Abd al-Dar ibn Qusay ibn Kilab. It is said that Abdul-Muttalib chose Amina, daughter of Wahb ibn Abd Manaf, who was the chief of Banu Zahra. He was the chief of the Banu Zahra clan. As a wife for his son Abdullah, and in the same setting he chose Hala bint Wuhayb ibn Abd Manaf, which is Amina's cousin, for himself. People said that Abdullah surpassed his father because Wahb, who is Amina's father, was the most honorable man in Quraysh. Abdullah married Amina in Mecca. And soon after, Abdullah was sent by his father to buy dates in Medina, where he died. The other version, or most of the historians, said that when he left Amina, Amina was pregnant. Most of the historians said that Abdullah was sent to Asham on a trading caravan of their Quraysh trading caravan to Asham, from Mecca to Asham, in trading caravan trip. When he left Amina, was pregnant. And Abdullah was absent for several months in Gaza. On his way back, he stopped for a longer rest. On coming back, he stopped for a longer rest with the family of his paternal grandmother. You know, paternal grandmother, the mother of Abdul-Muttalib, Salma bint Amr al-Najjariya, who belonged to the Najjar clan of the Khazraj tribe in Medina, a very big tribe in Medina. So he stopped there with his grandma, Salma bint Amr. He was preparing to join a caravan to Mecca when he felt ill. Then the caravan went on without him to Mecca with news of his absence and disease. Abdul-Muttalib immediately sent his eldest son, Al-Harith, to Medina. Upon his arrival, Al-Harith learned that his brother had died and that he had been buried there a month after falling ill. He was buried in Dar al-Nabigh al-Judi in Medina, or Nabigh al-Jadi or Judi in Medina. Al-Harith returned back to Mecca and announced the death of Abdullah to his father and to his wife Amina. Later on, Abdullah Mausoleum was demolished in 1976. He was reburied in Al-Baqiya graveyard next to the son of our Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him. He was 25 years old when he died. Most historians state that his death was 2 months before the birth of Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him. And some others said that his death was 2 months after the Prophet's birth, peace and blessing be upon him. When Amina was informed of her husband's death, she celebrated his memory in a most heart-touching elegy. Abdullah left very little wealth as inheritance, in terms of inheritance. He left very little wealth, 5 camels, a small number of goats, and a she-servant called Baraka or Umm Ayman, who would later serve as Prophet Muhammad's nursemaid. Peace and blessing be upon him. References.